Good morning. I have one more announcement, and I forgot to include it this morning for Pastor Mark. But this Tuesday, August 24th, 10:55 a.m., right before 11 o'clock, at the New Rescue Mission, at the building off of Martin Luther King Boulevard, they're giving our people in our church a tour of the new facility, if that's what you would like to do. There's a sign up in the back. See Debbie Urchison if not. So, you know, we have supported the rescue mission for quite some time, and I can't help but, you know, thinking when you read Matthew 25, that's the rescue mission right there, and that's what they do. A lot of God's work getting done at the rescue mission. So check it out in the back. And also, Stephanie Alesko had, I think, the very first Tiny Tim quote spoken here at the Church of the Rock ever. I don't remember that before. Well, today's sermon title is How We Live Makes a Difference. You know, I was reading over my notes this morning, and I thought, I said, you know, if we could make this even a little bit more personal, we say, how I live makes a difference, because it does. You know, this sermon today is a result for me getting news that a longtime brother in Christ died last Sunday. A close friend of mine for over 40 years had breathed his last breath on planet Earth 1 week ago today, and that has made a major impact in my life. Michelle and I became friends of he and his wife in the late 70s when we were living in Florida. He and I golfed together. We played softball on the same team. He taught me a little bit about fishing. You know, we just enjoyed being with one another. Michelle and his wife were brand new mothers almost at the very same time. We had a lot in common. We moved back to Ohio in 1981, and they remained in Florida. And, you know, just how life becomes so busy. Gary, my friend, and I lost contact with one another for a number of years. Then one day, a number of years ago, I was prompted to reach out, and we got reconnected. And then, not too long after that, Michelle and I traveled to Florida, and we visited with them. Since then, Gary and I have communicated basically on a daily basis, either texting, messaging, or through Facebook. You know, it was rare when 24 hours would go by without me hearing from him or him hearing from me. Might have been just, you know, hope you're having a good day, or how bad are the Indians, really, Reed? But there was just some communication. Like clockwork, every Sunday morning, I would get a text before church from him, usually a scripture verse, and then something like this: I'm praying for your sermon today. You know God's got this. Actually, that's how I knew something was wrong last Sunday. I didn't get a text. Gary remained the same guy today as the guy I became friends with 40 years ago, with the exception of one thing. He lost his health. Through a number of sicknesses and the resulting treatments for those sicknesses, Gary's physical well-being was pretty beat up. The last time he texted me, he weighed 126 pounds, which is 50-some pounds below his fighting weight. Currently, he was receiving chemotherapy treatments for the cancer that had returned to his body. The doctors also had installed a port through which his wife fed him 3 times a day. It was the only means of him getting any nourishment. The radiation he was given years ago damaged his esophagus to the point where he couldn't swallow anymore. This last month, he had lost his hair, but he did not lose his sense of humor. He sent me a picture of Uncle Fester for all of you Adams Family fans out there. He also asked me to pray for his energy because he said he just didn't have any. I tell you all this about my friend because, first of all, you would have never heard any of that from him. And second of all, I tell you this to preface the fact that he was one of the most positive, joy-filled, optimistic people that I knew. Not only was he optimistic regarding his own life, but his latest mission was to give others a reason to be optimistic for their lives. He had been a believer since he was a youngster, But here in the last few years, I believe that he had a renaissance of his faith. Can't tell you how many times he expressed just how thankful he was to God for his life. He was able to do that despite failing health because, you see, he had welcomed God's peace into his life. Colossians 3:15, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts and be thankful. You know, so often we're not experiencing the peace of Christ in our lives because we fail to allow his peace to rule. Gary definitely had his moments of apprehension. But eventually he would bring it all back to Jesus. And that's what we're all called to do. Given the incredible inheritance that we're promised, Hebrews. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom, say kingdom. Since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. You know, often I would look at my phone and there'd be a message, read, you and I are two very blessed men. And I'd respond, we are at that, my friend. One of his latest posts on Facebook was Jeremiah 17:7. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. Gary's daughter had recently blessed him with a second grandson. And there was little doubt what those two boys had meant to him. Proverbs, children's children are a crown to the aged. He wore those two crowns as though God gave them to him personally. Our grandchildren are our crowns, which we need in order to hide all the gray hair our own children gave us. God knew what he was doing. There's so much I'd like to tell you about Gary. He told me that he loved the message 2 weeks ago. He said, going through all that trouble of getting arrested just for a sermon illustration? He said, that was brilliant. He found something every day to be thankful for. Job 33:28, I shall live to enjoy the light of life. A month ago, he purchased a dozen of my books, and he began handing them out to people he thought could use some encouraging. It was the second such time that he had done something like that. Not sure all told how many books that he's given out, but he told me that he had two of them reserved for the nurses who were going to hook him up for his next chemo treatment. And Becky, Gary would want you to see that they got them. You know, I wrote a little tribute, and I posted it on my Facebook page last Monday. And on it I wrote, imagine going to your own chemotherapy treatment with the idea that you're going there to lift someone else's spirits. Philippians, he lived it. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. It was often that Gary looked to the interests of others. It's what he did. And it made him who he was, because the truth be told, how we live does make a difference. I prefaced this week's sermon with a bio of my friend so you'd get a little sense of who he was. Because knowing something about a person, knowing something about their story, and then knowing how they live their lives, that can tell you a whole lot about their faith. You know, I said a moment ago that it seemed as though Gary had a rebirth of his faith. Not that he got saved all over again. That doesn't happen. It was more like everything pertaining to the Lord and everything that he had discovered in Scripture became more alive to him. It became more personal. More real, if that makes any difference or makes any sense to you. It became obvious to me that his faith was now something he saw as tangible. Faith was no longer something that he was trying to pursue. Instead, faith was something he was now reaping the experience of. Hebrews 11:1, now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Gary lived his faith sure and he lived his faith certain, and it gave him peace. Brothers and sisters, that is a revelation. How many people do you know, including yourself, that run around in search of more faith? Because you believe somehow that more faith will make life less challenging, less difficult, or easier to cope with. All we have to do is look at the founding saints of Christianity. Come on, Peter, James, John, Paul. You think after Pentecost they lacked faith? Stephen? And yet look how difficult and look how challenging their lives were. Jesus, God incarnate. One could make an argument that he's the source of faith. And his adult life was nothing but one challenge, one difficulty after another. Where is it written that life is promised to be less challenging if we can just find more faith? Yeah, that's not written anywhere. Actually, Jesus spoke directly to that wrong thinking. The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." He replied, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to that mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it's going to obey you." Jesus didn't give them what they thought they needed, because what they thought they needed wasn't necessary. You know, Jesus had just finished teaching them what was expected from the lives of those who believe. His teaching caused them to feel a little inadequate. We'll never be able to do all that. They started thinking, there's no way that we can measure up to this standard Jesus was setting. Forgive people 7 times 70? They thought more faith was the answer. Lord, increase our faith. The problem was they were hearing a supernatural teaching, but they were trying to process it with natural thinking. They knew what they were capable of in the flesh and quickly realized, we'll never be able to do all that. When we start looking in the mirror for answers, and the mirror starts reminding us of our limitations, reminding us how often that we tried it on our own and we failed. When that happens, our confidence disappears immediately and we think, I'll never be able. But, see, the mirror is not the place we should be looking. Philippians 3:3. For it is we who serve God by His Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. King David, who had everything any man could ever want, anything he could ever need, and it was right at his disposal, he looked upward. He knew what he needed wasn't inward. He writes this, "For you have been my hope, sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth." Get your eyes off yourself thinking just a little more faith will give you more confidence. It will change your circumstances. It's going to make life easier and ultimately better. Anyone who buys into that lie has zero chance of experiencing any of God's peace whatsoever. But what you will experience, huh, is exhaustion, frustration, and probably question your own salvation from time to time. I must be experiencing all this misfortune and pain because I don't have enough faith. So you start that squirrel cage thinking of what do I have to do to get more faith? Should I read more scripture? Should I pray more often? I mean, both of those are awesome things to do, but they're not going to give you more faith. You have to quit looking for more faith. And instead, like David, start looking more often to the source of the faith you already have. Colossians 3:1-2. Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. My friend Gary set his heart and his mind on things above, and it resulted in his peace. Despite all the tribulations and trials, despite the chemo, despite the feeding tube, despite the hair loss and the weight loss, through it all, he experienced an inner peace that, quite frankly, many healthy Christians I know are not experiencing. Peter's actions out on Galilee on one early morning taught us everything about faith we need to know. Here's the account. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." Who else but Peter, right? "Lord, if it's you, tell me to come out to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand, caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" Now you might be saying to yourself, see, Peter needed more faith. Did he? You think he needed more faith? The only mortal who ever walked on water, he needed more faith? Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and he came to Jesus. You really think he needed more faith? "You of little faith," Jesus said. Well, the phrase "of little faith" in the Greek, oleagpistos, it's rendered "trusting too little." Obviously, Peter possessed plenty of faith. The man was supernaturally walking on the top of the Sea of Galilee. But his mistake was removing his trusting eyes from Jesus, the source of the supernatural, and putting them on instead himself, Peter, the fallible, the imperfect, the mortal. How often do we start out in a trying time trusting wholly in God? Lord, I'm putting this in your hands. The outcome is solely dependent on you, not me. I trust you, and I trust you alone. There are times when we start out with such faithful intentions. But then what happens? The doctor or whoever comes in with disappointing news we were not expecting. We get a setback. And immediately we start with the what ifs. What if the treatment doesn't work? What if I lose my job? What if my marriage fails? What if my children who are estranged don't return? You know, so often we start out like Peter, jumping out of the boat, trusting the Lord, and then also like Peter, the wind, the waves, the possibilities of what might happen get us looking at anything other than the Lord. And we start down that slippery slope of negative outcomes. We become gripped with fear. And immediately we cry, "Increase my faith." And God shakes his head. "Child, you have all the faith you ever need. You just got to trust it." You know, I know I've said this before. Faith is not parceled out. God doesn't give us just enough faith to save us at our salvation, and then down the road he starts adding a little, and then he starts adding a little bit more. Hebrews 10:39, "We do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." Where do you think that faith that saved us came from? Well, Paul wrote to the Ephesians, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God." If you are saved, then that means that you have saving faith. Faith that God himself has provided you. It's not insufficient faith. Why would God give anything insufficiently? He doesn't. "Consider it pure joy," James writes, "my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." As James tells us, our faith will be tested. And when it is, We are called to persevere. Perseverance in the Greek, it means this: patient, enduring, sustaining, waiting for. Listen, we all have to endure the trials of life. That's a given. No one wants to, but we have to. And the difference is how we endure. It was obvious that my friend Gary had discovered how to endure. He had come to a place where he stopped looking for more faith. He began to just trust God with the faith that he already had. Not that Gary wanted to die, or that he didn't want to be healed, because he didn't want to die, and he did want to be healed. Because the most precious thing, and he understood this, that any of us have is our life. He knew that. But here's the key. Dying or being healed, Gary was leaving it solely in the hands of his Lord. And what that did for him this last year or so was immeasurable. It enabled him to live every day gratefully. It enabled him to live every day looking to bless someone else. It enabled him to enjoy the moments of life with his two grandsons that he had. He said to me a number of times, "Reed, I want to write a book," or, "I want to get healthy so I can go visit the elderly." You know, there were times when he thought he needed to do more. I told him, "Gary, just keep doing what you're doing." Because I knew what he was doing was making a difference. He'd get hundreds of responses and comments on his posts. Given his health condition, Gary's major requests to me were to pray for his family and his friends who were hurting and that they were in need. He did that far more often than he asked me to pray for him. That is the result of someone resting and relying on their faith and allowing the peace of God to rule their heart. And let me tell you, once God's peace is ruling, then we're able to appreciate all that God has given us without the fear of what might happen. Man, I don't know about you, but that's where I want to be 24/7, 365, trusting God for everything. If we're always running around thinking that what we have is inadequate, and that we need more faith, or we're petitioning God to add to what he's already given us, because God forbid something might be just waiting around the corner. I mean, if that's what we're doing, how is that experiencing what Christ came to give us? John 10:10, "I've come that they may have life and have it to the full." Listen, having a full life isn't about experiencing less trials and less difficulties in our life. Having the full life that Christ came to give us is, regardless of our trials, regardless of our difficulties, Christ is my life. "I," Paul writes, "have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." You know, faith is not the ability to hold on while waiting for the other shoe to fall. Faith is knowing if the other shoe happens to fall, God's got that taken care of too. Our brother and sister, Mark and Karen Fabian, have been for the last 2 years living through hell on earth. November 2019, their son Mark Jr. was diagnosed with cancer that had infiltrated various parts of his body. They have been living this nightmare every single day. Now, I have not been privy to everything that has happened in their life since then. I, like most of you, I hear the highlights and some of the lowlights, rejoicing with them in the highs, praying for them in the lows. I'm believing God has the entire situation in his hands, trusting that the Lord has indeed healed Mark. He's back to teaching school, by the way. Praise God for that, huh? Yeah, absolutely. But see, in the last 2 years, their faith has been an inspiration to me and a lot of others. Watching them trust in the Lord with all their heart has reinforced to me once again, I can do the same. They, along with my friend Gary, have shown me it's not about running after more faith. It's about trusting in the faith that we've already been given. You know, our weak and feeble flesh may be calling out, I need more power, I need more strength, I need more faith, or I'm not going to make it. All the while, God is reminding us, as he did Paul, child, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. You know, it's natural for us to want God to remove all the obstacles in our life, eliminate all the temptations, heal all our diseases. For some reason, we're convinced that as long as we're experiencing things such as worry, anxiety, and fear, it must mean we lack faith. Here's a news flash. As long as you're living on planet Earth, worry, anxiety, and fear will be ever-present realities. However, they needn't rule our lives. They shouldn't keep us from living life to the fullest. Nor should they ever lead us to questioning our faith. Regardless of what we're going through momentarily, remember this. This entire life on earth is nothing but a mist of time in comparison to God's eternity, regardless of what we're going through momentarily. We can still have the abundant life Christ promised us. If my friend showed me anything in his life, it was that. He had just come home from his first chemotherapy treatment, and he texted me this. I felt so bad for this one young gal. He always said gal. She looked so sad, so I just started praying for her. That, my friends, is living 2 Corinthians 4 as it's meant to be lived. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Gary's eternal is now his reality. So I say, well done, good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Father God, although my heart is broken, I rejoice. Because that's your promise to every one of us. That we are absent with the body, that we are present with the Lord. And for that, I am so thankful. I pray for his family. I pray that his daughter, his wife, his son can teach those two little ones all about him. Bless them, comfort them, be with them, Lord. Let them know that as much as he loved them, that where he is at today is far greater. We thank you for your word. We thank you for how it encourages us. We thank you for how it enables us to get through this next day. I just pray a blessing over this body. I thank you, Father, for these faithful people. Continue to lead us and guide us, Father, and remind us that what you have given us is plenty. Actually, it's more than enough. Let us just learn to trust in it. I pray this in the name of the one who was and is and shall forever be. Amen. And amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Would you stand with me as we close today?